Hey there, everyone. Welcome back to Marketing Matchmaker. I am super excited about today's guest because what he does in his business and teaches is something that I am really passionate about, which is really learning from other business owners. Now, I have on today Jeremy Shapiro, who is the founder of Entrepreneurial Freedom, who helps founders find entrepreneurial freedom as true business owners through things like masterminds, which if you don't know by now, I love masterminds. They are one of the things that have really helped me to continue growing my business, learning for other people. So I'm going to let Jeremy really introduce himself to everyone. Jeremy, thank you for coming on today and playing with us.
Love it. Thanks so much for having me. And I love to hear how impactful mastermind groups have been for you and your business, as I've seen firsthand with so many business owners and founders and entrepreneurs over the years. Thank you for the great intro. My entire career has been an entrepreneur, which is decades now, I'm embarrassed and proud to say. And all of my businesses over those years have always been in the service and support of entrepreneurs and helping them to move towards what I call entrepreneurial freedom. And we can dig in more into what that means later on if you like, but really it's always been in the service of entrepreneurs. So everything we can chat about is within that realm of how do we empower entrepreneurs to get to that golden land of entrepreneurial freedom.
So first, I would love to talk about that. And before we get there, I have a question because I think it's different for everybody. So I don't know about you, but I learned the difference between being an entrepreneur and being a business owner, and also just kind of the different stages of business through the e-myth. What to you is the difference between being an entrepreneur and being a business owner?
Oh my gosh, I love that you brought up e-myth. One of my sort of foundational books that we talk about so much in our mastermind groups. On a short list also with the Cashflow Quadrant by Robert Kiyosaki. And I only mention that because my answer to your question blends the two. And we often do blend those as well as a number of other resources, right? So in Kiyosaki's Cashflow Quadrant, he talks about moving from being an employee, we all know what that is, to self-employed. And then you cross the chasm over to this world of being a business owner and then investor. And a lot of folks just view these as four like equal size squares. Just like on your to-do list, every item has an equal size checkbox, yet some are like Herculean tasks and others are 2-minute tasks, right? They're all the same size box, but the journey from being a self-employed person to a true business owner is huge. And I'll give you an example of sort of this journey, right? So if we go back to the E-Myth Revisited, we've got Sally, right? Sally loves making pies. So she decides to do what many of us do, and she goes on and opens a business to do the things she loves to do. She pursues her passion. So she opens a pie shop and quickly finds out that having a business is more than just about the work of the business of making pies. And she's got to deal with sales and marketing and hiring and bookkeeping and all the business stuff that is kind of the same across all businesses. And like, she suddenly has no time to do the thing that she loves to do, which is to make pies. Right? What this means, though, is you have really the worst kind of job, which is you have a business and yet you have all the worst parts of a job. So if you look at what we can call a business owner traditionally, someone who buys like a Subway franchise, these numbers are a little outdated, but like the average Subway owner makes like 60 grand a year and works like 90 hours a week.
Lord almighty.
And so they've like bought themselves this prison, but they are technically a business owner, right? Yeah. Now, you go back to Kiyosaki's definition, which is what we follow, which is this little litmus test. If you were to step away from your business for like a day or a week, would you come back to the same business, a better business, or like a dumpster fire? And for many business owners, quote-unquote business owners, they can't step away for like even a day. I had a client I was working with. He came to me as a solopreneur, as many businesses are. And he had a great business, right? He was selling hardware to retail stores that helped him to run part of their checkout process. The problem is, if anything came up and there was something was broken and they called him for support, they were offline until he could help them resolve this. But this was a guy who loved mountain biking and loved being in the outdoors and out being in the forest. And guess what? There's not a whole lot of cell phone coverage there. So there was this this need to take great care of his customers, which we all have because it's our name. We have a lot of, you know, pride and, right, you know, brand associated with that. So that's a good thing, to want to take great care of your customers. The problem was all dependent upon him, and that got in the way of him doing what was personally fulfilling for him mentally, for his physical health and everything. So like one of the first things we do is we're like, well, what can be done that doesn't block on him? Who can be like that first line of defense? And so he brought on a support person, and suddenly he had a first line of defense that when customers called or had a need, there was someone else to help them out. And so now he could go on about mountain bike ride. He could work on the marketing and the business. He could take a new client meeting. He could be fully present in what he was doing, knowing his customers were cared for. And that was such a huge shift of moving from being a solopreneur to a true business owner. So to answer your question, in sort of a long-winded but deep way, you know, a business owner, when you have a business, it means you can step away from the business and the business still runs independent of you being the blocker in the business, which for smaller business owners is so often the case.
And I think a lot of my audience are solopreneurs, right? They're in that place of having, they're excellent at what they do, whatever that thing might be. And they are trying to figure out how to do just that. How do I get myself to the point? For a lot of my clients, it's consistency of clients, but also how do I move myself out of having a job and into being a business owner? Go ahead.
What would you suggest? So like that next step is, you know, if you look at your business and you apply sort of the EMITH process of what are the roles in my business, right? Not the people, but the roles. Your name is going to be in all those boxes if you're a solopreneur, and that's okay, because you at least know what the roles are in the business. Your next step is to, you know, go into defining what those are and then start hiring for some of the roles that don't need to be you, right? So especially for like service-based businesses, when you're the one out there, you know, seeing the new business, closing the new business, doing the work, following up, invoicing and everything, like one of the things that you can start to have someone else do is like the billing piece of it. Handle the invoicing, the collection of payments, the sort of the admin side of it, right? You can then look at who else can be involved in your sales process. I'll share with you a quick story of one of our mastermind members had a business that was doing demolition work. So he had a crew of guys doing some of the work out there in the field, but he was still the one out there taking client calls, driving his truck to the job site, providing estimates, showing up every morning, making sure his guys got out there and got the work done. He was very present. One day he's on site, you know, talk to a client and, you know, hears someone call out and looks up to see the trailer from a truck rolling down the hill towards him with the bobcat still, you know, chained down to the back of it. And he looks up in time for this thing to run him over, crush him, drag him down the hill and down the street. And like when he comes to in the ICU, you know, bones aplenty, broken organs, you know, like it was ugly.
Oh.
And it was just awful. And so he finds himself, you know, after surgeries and all, sort of, you know, in the recovery room and just broken. And he's looking down and he's like, this whole business was built around him. He was the first guy in the company just being out there doing all the stuff. He'd hired the team, but all the rest of it was still blocking on him. He's like, well, I still got a business to run and he can't do it physically. So what Ryan did is he was like, well, I'm going to have to bring in systems, technology, and people. And so in terms of being at the job site in the morning, he brought in a tool. So his crew, when they got to the job site from their phone, could open an app and check in, and it geotagged and timestamped. They were checking in for the job site. Great. Technology took care of that. He got the job posting out and hired someone to go out and do the quoting and the estimates and invoicing. And he just kept repeating this iterative process of being forced to hire other people to run some of the systems in the business because he physically could not do that. And a funny thing happened is he realized the business was growing and he was increasing profitability even as he was taking on quote expenses, because A, he was spending less of his Ryan time in the business, and B, the business was growing. So like the overall return on investment for the hours he put into the business and the profit that came out to him as a business owner got better and better and better and better. So sometimes we choose, as I've done and many clients have done, to do less in the business and have others do more. and getting a higher ROI that way. And other times, like in Ryan's case, that decision was forced upon him and he had to react and create those systems. And I don't know about you, but I sure would prefer to do it proactively than to have to do it reactively.
True story, my friend. I say this all the time, you know, the universe whispers to you and then it kind of yells and then maybe it taps you on the shoulder. By the time you get hit by something like Ryan did, that's a painful lesson. It is much better to listen to the whispers to start that growth. So
yeah, it's a wonderful transition.
It is. It absolutely is. So what are the biggest mistakes that people make when they are trying to scale their business?
So there's a few, but you know, I'll categorize them in, well, let's talk about mindset, right? So one challenge I see, especially for solopreneurs, especially if you're like in a service-based business, you're an expert, you're a service provider, and it's like you doing the thing, right? And our story from before, Sally making the pies, right?
Right.
There's a few mindset things that can come with that. One is this idea of nobody else being able to do something as well as you can. How could you hire someone to do what you do, right? And that's a fallacy, right? That's just head trash that we can work through. And I've done this a ton with folks. There is a system to the thing that you think is your magical golden unicorn touch. You're great at what you do, and that's good, but there is a standard you can create so others can do things to your standard, to the point you'd be proud to put your signature on that and say, you know, this is my work, my company, right? So you absolutely can get out of your own head and have the right systems and processes to allow others to do work that you're proud of, right? The second is this idea that someone is going to take your methodology and steal it and go start a competing company. And once the secrets are out of your mind, the Coca-Cola formula is gone and everyone's going to have their own competing company. And like, look, I know what you do is great work, you know, to our listeners who are listening here. Yes. Most people aren't as crazy as you and I are and wanting to go create their own business. Most of the world wants a job, wants everything that comes with employment, right? The reliable paycheck, the lack of stress that keeps, you know, maybe you up at night, of running a business and all the challenges that come with that. They want to know they got a paycheck and benefits and a defined job to do and know where the responsibility ends. They don't want to be a business owner with all the responsibilities that comes with that. So they're not going to go out there and open a competing company. Yes, some might go out there and do that, but it's still never going to be the brand that you have and the company that you have with the same marketing processes and the same service fulfillment and all of that. Good luck to them. And maybe you get a competitor. It's unlikely. And even if it happens, it's okay. The freedom that comes with allowing others to run the business is tremendous. So like those are two of the mindset things I think that often get in the way of solopreneurs starting to grow and get that first hire, right? But the biggest thing I see again and again is as an entrepreneur, it's lonely at the top, right? When you run your own business, who do you talk to about your challenges? And also who do you talk to about your big wins?
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but like when you try and have conversations about what's going on in your life with friends with the JLB, like
they don't get it.
You're talking two different languages. Right? Like, you know, so if you're facing a business challenge and you talk to your employees about that, like they start polishing up the resumes, mm-hmm. right? You know, can you talk to your spouse about that? Your friends, your family, right? You know, like your vendors pull credit terms when they hear business is tough right now. Your customers start looking elsewhere when you tell them business is tough. So like, who do you talk to about that stuff? On the flip side, when you have a win, when you close that big contract, when you have your best quarter yet, your best year yet, when you are working fewer hours, and yet pulling more profit from the business, like who do you share that big win with, right? So don't go at this alone. This is one of the biggest benefits of having a mastermind group of like-minded individuals who are growth focused, who are lifelong learners, who aren't your customers, your family, your vendors, or any of those things, right? These are people who've been there and done that, who have their own areas of genius, who want nothing but the best for you and are there to help you uncover those blind spots in your business that you're not even seeing. The ones who can celebrate your big wins and successes, the ones who can comfort and help and assist you through the challenges you face in business because they've been there, done that, have the resources and the wherewithal and the know-how to help you out. So surround yourself, get that peer group around you.
That is, I will tell you, that is the biggest thing I learned from masterminds. honestly, because you're right. When I first started running my business and growing it, my husband's been in corporate his entire life. I can't talk to him. He's not going to understand my struggles.
Right.
And also, yes, he celebrates my wins, but he doesn't understand them, right? Like when I say, you know, this happened in digital marketing for my client, and he's like, okay, right? So he doesn't necessarily. So
great job.
I am so in line with masterminds for that reason, because you can create that community. Here's the other thing that I really learned from masterminds. Sometimes that question that you're afraid to ask, someone else is not. They will ask the question that you really want to know.
Yeah, it's interesting. We have, for our mastermind, like you should never just go out there and like sign up for some high-end membership, you know, and write the largest check you've ever written for your business to join a group of strangers you know nothing about. Like that's not sound business advice. This is why we have for our mastermind groups what we call our test drive. It gives you a chance to try out the group for a full day, experience one of our full-day mastermind groups, and see what it's like as a member. And you get a hot seat that day as well, just like all the rest of the members do. And here's what I think is so interesting. Everyone comes into the group with sort of their big burning question, right? So there's their areas of expertise. This is the stuff they know that they know. There's their big question, which is the stuff they know that they don't know. And for people joining us for a test drive, usually they're like, hey, if I got an answer to this thing, whew, this is a good day. But the real value and the biggest aha moments and the biggest light bulbs that go off, the moments where I see that smile come across the face and the pen starts scribbling down notes, that never happens during an individual's hot seat for themselves. Mm-hmm. It's during everyone else's sessions. This is where you're getting exposure to the things you didn't know. And therein lie the opportunities. That's where the opportunities wait. That's where the opportunities are waiting to be uncovered and discovered, is others sharing what's going on in their business, what's working, what's not, what their challenges are, and where they need help. That is where it's an interactive conversation, and our people visiting during a test drive get to dig a little deeper and ask, wait, tell me more about that. Well, what vendor did you use? Wait, can you go back a screen? Can we see the real numbers? Can you show us this and that? And you get the behind the scenes look at real businesses and what's not working and what is working. And you get the introductions you need so you can take the best practices and do those, and take the biggest mistakes and avoid those, go around that detour on the map and not have to go through it yourself.
Yeah. So when someone's looking for a mastermind, what should they be looking for?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So there's this interesting idea, like you never want to be the biggest fish in the pond, right? So if you're running a nine-figure business and you're in a room of folks who, you know, are just getting going, like there's not gonna be much two-way going on there. Right. On the other end, if you're like the smallest person in the room, you know, you're just getting started in a room of like seven-figure businesses, there's not as much you can add to that conversation. So there's this balance. You want to be in like roughly the same part of the journey with other business owners.
Yeah.
Right. This is something, you know, that I've always worked with, like established businesses that are looking to grow and scale. You know what you're selling, you know how to sell it. You have clients that aren't just, you know, people you knew ahead of time. You've got a process and you now want to scale up because you plateaued, right? You're growth focused. Well, founders kept finding me who like wanted to start a business. And so when you're in that earlier stage, you have the how do I questions. You're not refining something, you're looking to start something.
Right.
And so like those folks weren't a fit for our mastermind group. But like as I kept finding more founders who were seeking us out, we actually created a founders group, right? And so now we have a place to put these folks where we have not a full day meeting. It's, you know, a morning meeting. It's not the same investment. It's a smaller membership investment in the group, right? And it's more of a how do I and accountability and all that versus our traditional mastermind group is for established scaling businesses. So you want to find, you'll make sure you're in the right community in that way, that you can both give and receive within that group, right? You also want to make sure it's the right format. I've found that mastermind groups generally fall into sort of three main buckets and then sort of two variations of that, right? You're going to have what I call your destination mastermind groups, right? These are usually your high-end groups. You're writing a 5 to 6 figure a year check to be part of those groups. You're taking a week off a few times a year to hop on a plane and fly somewhere and meet for a few days in person. And there's value in those. I've written those checks. I've been part of those groups. And my gosh, if I had like life and business changing outcomes from those groups. So there's definitely value there, right? On the other end, we have what I call like your coffee groups or your accountability groups. You might hop on a Zoom call or go to the coffee shop once a week and catch up for like 30 to 90 minutes, right? In a week-long period, there's not been enough time to implement business-changing things in the business. You can get some tactical stuff done, but you can't really get those big changes in your business in a one-week period. They're also usually free to low cost, and so you have generally high turnover and relatively low show rate, right? Folks don't show up, the groups kind of fizzle, there's not really much skin in the game, right? On the other end, those destination groups, if you're only meeting two times a year, if you come back in 6 or 9 months, you could have sold a business, launched the new one, drastically pivoted, changed everything. And then like the whole right. conversation, like everything has changed and there's not that right cadence. So what I found worked really well is for the Bay Area Mastermind, we do a once a month full day meeting. In a 1 month period, you can put some good juicy accountability items on your list that are not just the small tactical things, but the big things that can change your business over the course of a month. And you get that peer accountability from those who can help hold you socially accountable. Because as the boss,
yeah.
guess what? Like, if you don't want to do something in your business, you don't have to. and that can be a problem.
Absolutely. Right?
So you do want that accountability. You also want to make sure that it's a group of people who aren't just there to receive, but they're also there to give and to share and who are willing to ask you the tough questions, right? Are willing to lovingly challenge you, right? And so you only get a feel for that once you're in the room. And then that last sort of variation I was sharing is you'll find most groups out there are what I call guru-led groups, right? We've all seen these. There's an expert, you love their book, so you go to their live event, you love their live event, so you buy their course. And sort of as you go through this, sort of the next step in the ascension is they offer a high-end mastermind group. People are usually joining those groups to rub shoulders and hang out with that expert. You don't really care who else is in the room. Everyone's there because this expert is there, right? There's value in that. But the other kind of group is the peer-led groups. And this is what I love, is when you have a peer advisor group, they are facilitated, right? So there is still structure to the group and there's still someone managing and running everything. But everyone's there for their benefit and the group's benefit, because you want your peers who are there to look out for you with your best interests in mind and who want to help you to grow. And you're there for that as well. And then you have someone else who makes all the meeting happen behind the scenes and provides the resources between the meetings and all. So that's why, like at the Bay Area Mastermind, we have that monthly cadence. It's a full day of working on versus in your business. It's for established scaling businesses, and it's expertly facilitated, but it's still a peer advisory group versus the guru-led.
I loved the breakdown of masterminds because I don't think a lot of people understand that. And I will tell you, the people in my audience, the majority of them are looking at those guru-led masterminds as the pinnacle, as the thing that they should be shooting for. And it might not actually be what they need. So I do love that. Okay. As we're wrapping up this conversation, I want to take it back to marketing for 1 second. And we're going to talk about your business here. So my question is, what is the best thing that you have done to market your business so that you are filling these masterminds?
Yeah, that's it's a really good question. And I have an answer that's half of what you're asking for and half not. So bear with me. So what's been the most valuable for me, not just in this business, but in my businesses over the years, has been being part of a mastermind group. And that's because we get that exposure to other kinds of businesses, right? You can go find your industry groups, right? Whatever your trade is, you've got trade groups and conferences where you can go meet people like you who do what you do in the same way you do. And you can keep on doing that stuff and getting the same results as everyone else, right? Like that's okay, but you don't really pivot and differentiate. With a mastermind group, you get exposure to different business models and different ways of doing business. And specifically within marketing, I love the conversations where we have what I call the cross-pollination of ideas. And I'll share with you an example of that. You know, we had an e-commerce business in the room and a retail brick and mortar shop in the room. The e-commerce business owner is talking all about how every time emails get sent out, people click the links, they buy the stuff online, and money comes in the door. And you can look at stats like earnings per click and open rates and click-through rates and, you know, buy-through rates, all these different things. And the retail store owner who has a successful business is looking at this saying, wait a minute, like, you do all this with just email and online? Like,
right.
Well, you know, how do you do that? And is, you know, over the next month, puts in place at the register asking customers for their email address. Puts in place a VIP membership club for customers, right, that get perks of being part of that. Starts sending out emails, and wouldn't you know it, sends an email out and money comes in the door. And this business owner is like, whoa, like, no one's doing this with my kind of business. This is amazing. And they're getting that cross-pollination of how to grow their business in a new channel. On the flip side, the e-commerce business owner is looking at the retail store owner saying, you do direct mail? So like, you buy a list of people who don't know you, and then you send something in the mail, and then people like buy from you, and you know how to track back to who bought and who's a good buyer and like all this. Like, how do you do that? Who do you use for your direct mail? Where do you buy your lists? Do you send a postcard, a letter, a lumpy mail? Like, what are you sending out? And they can have this whole conversation. And over the next month, the e-commerce owner buys a list, sends out direct mail postcards with an offer, has people who've never heard of him before and who never expressed a need for this kind of product going to the site, ordering online, and they know who bought, what promo they took advantage of. They're tracking everything else through by adding a new channel of marketing to the business, simply by being in the mastermind room across from somebody else, building their own business successfully, albeit in a different way. And I've got dozens of those kinds of stories, but like, that's just an example of hearing marketing success from a different kind of business and adding it into your own. And so that's one of the huge values in a mastermind group. And similarly for me in building our mastermind groups, seeing what others do to grow their business and implementing it for myself has been huge. So like, that's, I would say, the big takeaway is, you know, be a fly on the wall in others' conversations around how they built their business that are outside your industry and cross-pollinate that back into yours.
I love that. I love that. I do. I think whether they call it a mastermind group, I think people correlate mastermind groups and group coaching and all in kind of the same sphere. And they're not necessarily in the same sphere. A group coaching is going to be led by that coach or consultant or whatever. Whereas the mastermind is much more, well, if it's done well anyway, interactive.
Yeah. Yeah. In my experience, and this has actually come up before, this differentiation between group coaching and mastermind groups, right? Group coaching, there's typically more of like a curriculum,
right?
And there's someone leading a group, a class, a cohort through this curriculum together. And that's great. There's a ton of value in that. If you want to know how to do something, you can get group coaching that will move you from A to B on a structured, you know, process that has seen success for people like you,
yeah.
Right? The mastermind group is totally different in that you're getting exposure to things you didn't know that you didn't know about. And that's where those big aha moments, that's where those big pivots come from. You know, we had a doctor with a traditional medical practice, cash-based medical practice, right? That's great, doing all the right things, but learned about the whole idea of continuity and subscription revenue and membership models and created a whole membership program that was not dependent on a brick and mortar medical practice.
Yeah.
Getting the ideas of people who created courses online, sharing their best practices in the mastermind group, was able to add in an online education piece and a paid membership continuity program to his medical practice. So we see this kind of stuff all the time. We've seen attorneys who are sole practitioners, right, scale and build up their business by taking the best practices of others and finding an angle for that in their own business. So like, you can do this. You can learn what you didn't know simply by being around others who are doing things in different industries in their own way.
I love that. I love that. I so appreciate this conversation, Jeremy. I think my audience is also going to walk away with a ton of value when it comes to just understanding what you didn't know, you didn't know.
Yep.
So how do those that want to get a hold of you, that are looking for a mastermind, how do they find you? Where should they connect with you?
Yeah, we're on all the socials and everything under Bay Area Mastermind. You can also find me, Jeremy Shapiro, on LinkedIn. But really the best place is at bayareamastermind.com. We have all your resources there in terms of like how to find a group, how to create a group, what to look for in a group, what a mastermind is, how hot seats run, all that stuff, and a ton more resources we have for business owners and entrepreneurs who are looking to grow is all right there on our site for you to enjoy. If you're interested in joining one of our mastermind groups, we have our test drive process like I talked about. You can complete a, you know, no obligation application online, and then we go over it and we talk about where there might be opportunities. And look, I know our group isn't a fit for everyone, but that's why we have an application process and we have a conversation about it. And all that is, like I mentioned, at bayareamastermind.com.
That's fantastic. I will have all of Jeremy's links in the show notes for those of you that didn't have a pen to write it down. Just head over to the show notes and you can connect with Jeremy. For all of the rest of you out there that are looking to grow your business, increase your revenue, and scale your impact, a mastermind can be a fabulous way to learn the things that you maybe didn't know you didn't know. So I encourage you to find that group, find that mastermind that can help you to grow. Until next time, get out there and do your thing. Thank you for listening to the Marketing Matchmaker podcast. If you enjoyed this episode, I would love to hear your feedback. Please head over to Apple iTunes and leave a review so we can hear from you. And if you are a coach, consultant, or online course creator who are looking to grow your business, increase your income, and scale your impact, connect with me at yourmarketingmatchmaker.com. I look forward to hearing from you.